Brothers, sisters, let us gladly give to God our all, our best. Service hearty, thorough, honest, with a living love impressed. All our duty, all our striving, all our time to Him belong. Praise Him then with true devotion, come before Him with a song. By His mercy, by His bounty, by the gift of Christ His Son.
Good morning, and welcome to Prince of Peace Lutheran Church in Thousand Oaks, California. I'm Pastor Noah Bader, and I'm so thankful that you and your family are joining us for online worship this morning. If you happen to live in the area, we would love to meet you and to worship with you in person. We do that every Sunday morning here at 9 a.m. outdoors. And as it looks like we might be slipping back into the purple tier of COVID restrictions, our plan is to continue offering that outdoor worship service into the near future. Today is the second to last Sunday in the church year. And as we started last week, these last couple of Sundays of the year, we are spending time listening to Jesus as He teaches us about the end of time. What will that look like? How do we prepare for it? Well, last week Jesus told us a story and an analogy that He used in comparing it to a bridegroom Himself, Jesus, who was coming, and there were 10 bridesmaids. 5 of them were ready for His arrival, 5 of them were not. To be prepared, and the way in which Jesus wants us to be prepared is to make sure that our faith is ready to receive Him, that we are fed and prepared and strong in our trust and resolve for the Lord and His return. Today, if you could even say this, I think it's real though, the Lord is going to get even more personal, because He's going to ask you some questions about your stuff. What have you been doing with all of your possessions, with your time, with the talents and abilities that you have? The Lord says the day is going to come when He returns, and He's going to ask you that very question. And the reason that the Lord is interested in what you've been doing with your stuff is because it really isn't your stuff. It's His. The songwriter tells us the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And so everything that you have and everything that you are, Jesus says, that all comes from Me. And so I want to know that the things that I have blessed you with, you've put them to good use. You've used them to My glory and to love and serve those around you. Some hard questions that Jesus is going to force us to ask ourselves this morning. But in the midst of all of it, we still have that comfort of our Lord Jesus, who is the good gift giver. And He doesn't just come to give us stuff. He comes to give us Himself, and along with Him, the forgiveness of sins. And when we misuse and mismanage the things that God gives to us, there is Jesus covering our life in His perfect blood and righteousness, lifting us up, restoring us, encouraging us, and sending us back out, saying, put these gifts to use for Me and for My kingdom, and for the betterment of your neighbor. The order of service that will follow can be found in the worship folder. There's a digital copy of it linked beneath this video if you'd like to pull it up and have it there. But most of the things that we will be saying and singing this morning will be right there on the screen. May the Lord be with you and bless you this morning as we worship by means of this wonderful gift that He's given to us known as technology. And He promises to do so because He's here with us wherever and whenever His word is proclaimed. God bless each and every one of you.
Still whatever He does, and follow though dark my road, He holds me that I shall not fall, and so to Him I leave it all, and so to Him I leave it all. Whatever my God ordains is right, He never will deceive me. He leads me by the proper path, I know He will not leave me. I take content what He has said, His hand can turn my griefs away, and patiently God ordains is right, though now this cup in drinking may bitter seem to my faint heart, I take it all unshrinking. My God is true each morning new, sweet comfort yet shall fill my heart, and pain and sorrow shall depart, and pain and sorrow shall depart. Whatever my God ordains is right, here shall my stand be taken.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. God invites us to come into His presence with humble and penitent hearts. Therefore, let us acknowledge our sinfulness and ask Him to forgive us. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this, I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Father in heaven, has been merciful to us and has given His only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by His authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. For the well-being of all people everywhere, that they may receive from you all they need to sustain body and life, hear our prayer, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the spread of your life-giving gospel throughout the world, that all who are lost in sin may be brought to faith in you, hear our prayer, O Christ. Christ, have mercy. For patience and perseverance in this life, that we may not lose the hope of heaven as we await your return, hear our prayer, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. Lord God Almighty, so rule and govern our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit that we may always look forward to the end of this present evil age and to the day of your righteous judgment. Keep us steadfast in true and living faith and present us at last holy and blameless before you. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning is recorded in the Old Testament book of Isaiah, chapter 1. The Lord saw right through Israel's empty worship. They were still coming to the temple. They were still giving him sacrifices and offerings, but none of it was accompanied by faith. None of it came from a true love and honor and hope in the Lord. And so the Lord says, stop. He calls them to repent of their empty worship. And because he is so merciful, he promises forgiveness and grace. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Listen to the law of our God, you people of Gomorrah. The multitude of your sacrifices, what are they to me? Says the Lord. I have more than enough of burnt offerings, of rams and the fat of fattened animals. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. When you come to appear before me, who has asked this of you, this trampling of my courts? Stop bringing meaningless offerings. Your incense is detestable to me. New moons, Sabbaths, and convocations, I cannot bear your evil assemblies. Your new moon festivals and your appointed feasts, my soul hates. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you spread out your hands in prayer, I will hide my eyes from you. Even if you offer many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash and make yourselves clean. Take your evil deeds out of my sight. Stop doing wrong. Learn to do right. Seek justice. Encourage the oppressed. Defend the cause of the fatherless. Plead the case of the widow. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A second reading comes from the Apostle Paul's letter to the Roman Christians, chapter 12. For the majority of the first 11 chapters of St. Paul's letter, he addresses and expounds on the grace that God has given to us in Christ, that our sins are forgiven, that we have been set free from sin and the fear of death. Here, Paul transitions a little bit and now asks the question, what does a life that has been given all of that in Christ now look like? Paul says, it's a living sacrifice. Not the empty sacrifices that we just heard Israel was giving to God, but your whole life, a life that has been blessed not only with God's grace and love and forgiveness, but talents and abilities and riches and blessings. And the Lord Jesus now says, use those as a church. Use those as my body to be a blessing for one another and for the world. Paul writes, therefore I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourselves more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the measure of faith God has given you. Just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel appointed for the 24th Sunday after the festival of Pentecost is recorded in the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 25. These words will serve as the basis for our sermon this morning. Jesus speaks. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, and to another 1 talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received the 5 talents went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more. So also the one with the 2 talents gained 2 more. But the man who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received the 5 talents brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 talents. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with the 2 talents also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 talents. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who had received the 1 talent came. Master, he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid, and I went out and I hid your talent in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put the money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. Take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For everyone who has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken from him. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. We confess the Christian faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. My dear sisters and brothers in Christ, the five love languages. Have you heard of this? It's the title of a book written by author Gary Chapman. He wrote it back in about 1992, in which he breaks down the five different ways people, particularly husbands and wives, express and receive love. Initially, it wasn't all that well received. It only sold like 8,500 copies in the first year it was released. It, It sold about double that in the second year, but then after that it took off. And it has been on the New York Times bestseller list since 2009. So what are the five languages of love that Chapman lays out? Well, the first is words of affirmation. Then there's quality time, receiving gifts, acts of service, and physical touch. So which love language do you speak? What is your preferred way of expressing love and then receiving love? It's a fascinating book because, for example, it helps explain why when you do something that you perceive to be an example of a loving gesture for your spouse or for your kids or for your friends, but they don't receive that as a loving gesture, or at least not as much of a loving gesture as you had intended, it helps explain why that is. Because just because you thought it was an act of love, and that's the way that you express love, it doesn't necessarily mean that that's the way that someone receives love. So, for example, fellas, you can't just keep buying flowers every time you do something stupid. You can't just give your wife flowers and then expect that that's going to make it better. Now, sometimes that might work. And if your wife's love language is receiving gifts, it will probably work better than others. But maybe that isn't the language that your wife speaks. Maybe that isn't the way that she prefers to receive love. You might be able to save yourself some money and even time. Maybe her language of love is acts of service. And so instead of driving and buying flowers, you could actually just spend 5 minutes folding the laundry. The reason that this book was on my mind this week is because of the story that we just heard Jesus tell in our gospel reading from Matthew chapter 25. If words of affirmation is your love language, and it's mine, and I would assume that it's probably a number of others as well, then the words the master speaks to the first two servants for you will probably be some of the most beautiful, some of the most powerful, some of the most loving and comforting words in all of Scripture. Well done, good and faithful servant. Come and share your master's happiness. I mean, can you picture for a moment just the look on God's face as he's saying those words? As he's opening up his arms wide and inviting you to come and spend all of eternity with him, as he looks over your entire life, and the only thing he can say is, well done. It's a powerful image. It's a loving image. On the other hand, there is another option, I suppose. Maybe you're not convinced that God will say that to you on the last day. There is a third servant, and he hears something terribly different. He hears the master say something that is a little more sobering, and in fact, downright terrifying. You wicked, lazy servant. Throw him outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Which will your master, which will your God say to you? Because it has to be one or the other, Jesus says. And if your answer begins with a phrase like, well, I hope, it doesn't cut it. Because remember, these stories in Matthew chapter 25, this is Jesus giving an answer to the disciples' question about the end times and the things that are going to happen that are going to point to and lead up to the day when Jesus returns and what it will look like on the last day. And so Jesus wants them, his disciples, he wants you to be aware of the signs that will lead up to and will accompany his return so that you can be confident when it comes how it will all go down. So Jesus tells a story about himself and his servants, his disciples, about you, about me, about all believers in and followers of Jesus Christ. Jesus says that this master himself, he is going away on a long journey. And that long journey really comprises the time that we would consider to be the whole New Testament era, from Jesus' departure, his ascension into heaven, through his return on the last day. But Jesus doesn't leave his church empty without his physical presence. He blesses all of us in different ways with differing amounts of his possessions, each according to our own ability. Jesus said he called his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, and to another 1 talent, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. Now, when you and I hear the word talent, we tend to think of skills or aptitudes. You know, some of you are athletically talented or musically talented or academically talented. And in fact, we get our word talent from the very Greek word that Jesus uses here in this parable. But here, a talent in Jesus' day was actually a large sum of money. It was a certain weight of money. And a couple times throughout this past summer, we have talked about a denarius. Remember the coin, the standard everyday coin that was used to pay a day's wage. You work for a day, you got a denarius. Well, a talent was about the equivalent of 6,000 denarii. Or if you break it down, 6 days of week of work, 6 days a week of working, it's about 20 years salary. Or if you were going to weigh it, it was 75 pounds. 1 talent weighed 75 pounds. And for example, if that was gold in today's market, 1 talent was $1.7 million. Now, I explain all of that and I share all of that information with you, not because it's important for you to be able to transform or understand the conversion rate of first century Roman money to American money, but to understand the generosity with which this master, your Savior, operates. It's not like he just gives his servants a bone. He didn't just give them a couple months' rent money. He doesn't just leave his a couple dollars on the counter and say good luck. He lavished them with more blessings than they could have ever earned. He took those servants and he transformed them into multimillionaires overnight. And two of those servants, they take their master's possessions, those blessings, those talents, and they put them to work. They use what the master gave them, and it produced an equal return. The man who had received 5 talents produced 5 more, and the man who got 2 produced 2 more. And Jesus is ecstatic. And I love this line. This might be my favorite one. Jesus, as the master, says, "You have been faithful with a few things. A few things. I will put you in charge of many things." Only Jesus would look at multi-millions of dollars and say, "That's just a few things. There's so much more I have in store for you." I mean, the grace of your God, the generosity. He entrusts you with his own wealth, with everything that you are and everything that you have. And then when he returns, he promises to give you even more. He takes you from being a servant and he turns you into a spiritual millionaire overnight. And then he says, just wait. There's infinitely more where that came from when I return. Now, contrast that master, your God, with what the third servant, the 1 talent servant, claimed him to be. Master, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here's what belongs to you. This master, a hard man, the word he uses is harsh or stubborn. You mean the guy who just gave you a couple $1 million is harsh? This guy is unfair in how he operates and how he treats his servant to the degree that of all the emotions you could muster up to respond, to react to his gracious generosity is fear? I'm not buying it. And neither does Jesus. The master points out the servant's own hypocrisy. He says, "You wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown, and apparently that I gather where I have not scattered seed." Well, if that's really what you thought, if that was the case, then you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. So because you thought I was a harsh and unfair to my servants, you decided to do nothing? That would be like if you said to your boss, "Look, boss, I know that you have the power, the ability to fire me at a moment's notice. And I don't want you to fire me. So to avoid you firing me, I'm just not going to come into work anymore." Seriously? If that's what you really think, and that's what you're really trying to avoid, then what you would actually do is the exact opposite of that. So what really was this lazy and wicked servant's great sin? Was it that he didn't earn his master more money? Take everything you know from this master, your God, even just what you know of him in this brief parable. And tell me, what do you think his reaction would have been upon his return if that third servant had said something like this? "Master, I took what you gave me, and I guess you could say I put it to work. Not always in the most constructive ways. I probably wasted as much of it as I properly used. I was far from being faithful, and from what I can tell, it didn't produce much of a return. I don't have much, actually. I don't have anything of value to offer back to you. And I readily admit all of this only because I know you to be a gracious master, that you gave me what I did not deserve, and you blessed me with that which I could never have earned. So all I can say is, Master, have pity on me, have mercy on me, a worthless servant." Does this master throw that servant out into the darkness? Not a chance. And you want to know why? Because this parable isn't about money. It isn't about the rate of return. It's not even about whether or not you are faithful or unfaithful. Because if that were the case, if that's what this whole parable was about, then it would have been a much shorter parable with only one servant, the unfaithful one. Because there's not a single one of us who could look God in the face and say, "God, I have been absolutely faithful with everything that you have ever entrusted to me without fail." You just confessed at the beginning of this service to the exact opposite. So this lazy and wicked servant's great sin wasn't that he didn't make enough money to please his master. It wasn't even that he was unfaithful. It's that he wanted to believe a lie about his master, a lie that he himself had created, that this master was ruthless that he was merciless, that he was harsh. And if he could convince himself that that's the kind of master he had, well, then who in their right mind would ever work for him? And all that really did was show that he didn't actually know his master at all. And that false faith, his lack of trust in his good and gracious God, against all the evidence that the master had laid out before him, revealed in what he did, or in this case didn't do, with what his master gave him. So the real question that this parable causes us to ask ourselves is not, have I been faithful or unfaithful? We know the answer to that question. The question that this parable causes us to be confronted with is, what kind of master do you have? What kind of God do you have? Do you have the kind of God who gives and gives and gives and gives? Or do you have the kind of master who demands, who takes what isn't his, or treats you harshly? And before you answer, remember, we don't have to dive down into the depths of your soul to find the answer. Just look at your life. How you use what God has given you will reveal what kind of God you believe you have. So how do you use your time? Do you view each day as a gift of God's grace or as a curse of God's anger? That the Lord's mercies are new every morning, or that every morning just brings more trouble? That to live is Christ and to die is gain, or to live is everything because once I die, well, then the fun's all over? How do you use your stuff, your money and possessions? Do you view them as examples of the overflow of God's grace, acknowledging that you brought absolutely nothing into this world and you will take absolutely nothing out of it? Or are they proof? Your wealth, your possessions, is that proof of what you alone have accomplished? That you have brought everything good into your life and no one, not even God, will be able to take it out of your hands. How do you use your talents and abilities? This has to be one of the most common things I hear from people as a pastor. Pastor, I don't have any talents. I don't have any gifts. I don't have any special abilities that I could put to use for the benefit of this congregation or the benefit of anyone else for that matter. Is that so? I would encourage you to read the parable again. Even the worthless, lazy, wicked servant who does nothing was given a talent. You see, God doesn't leave any of his servants talentless. So what's yours? And if you honestly don't know, ask your spouse, what is my talent? Ask your best friends, what are my special gifts and abilities? And if they have nothing to give you, nothing to offer you, come ask your pastor. I'll give you a whole list. Is it really that you don't know what the Lord has blessed you with the ability to do? Or is it that you're just a fear if it becomes known, someone's actually going to ask you to use it? Or how about us collectively, this congregation, this body of Christ, as St. Paul calls us? How do we use our time, our offerings and resources, our talents and abilities? Do we, as a congregation, reflect a God who gives and gives, or a God who demands and takes away? And how can we tell? Well, is our collective spirit one of reaching out and welcoming and giving and sharing the grace and mercy that God has given to us? Or do we prefer to remain this small, little, tight-knit, comfortable congregation where I really get everything that I want out of it because I don't have to actually put that much into it? Would you be more excited to see a new family sitting in your pew because they're here to meet Jesus? Or would you be more upset that they took your seat? Are you willing to give up some of your comfort to make sacrifices for the sake of someone new? Or would you prefer that they just go to the back of the line and pay their dues like everyone else? Are you willing to give, to invest your resources into this ministry? Do you give your offerings because you know that you can never outgive your God? Or because you feel guilty every now and then, and so you want to make sure that you throw him a bone here or there? Or would you prefer that the church just shut up about money altogether? Brothers and sisters, what kind of master, what kind of God do you have? You have a God who loves. You have a God who lives to give. Not only does he give you your life, bringing you into this world, but then he fills that very life with every good and perfect gift. Every minute of every day, all your talents and abilities, your stuff, your finances, your parents, your spouse, your kids, your friends, and he blesses you so richly so that through you, he would bless everyone else around you. And so even when you don't see a return, Jesus does. And if you think that isn't comforting or beautiful because your life isn't as glamorous as you had hoped, that you don't have nearly the amount of things or money you wanted, you're not near as talented or successful as others, then never forget that the greatest gift God ever gave you, the most precious, the most expensive, the most beautiful gift is one that you could never have bought and will never be monitored or managed by the ups and downs of the stock market. He's only found on a cross. To know that God did not spare his own son, but gave him up into death for you. And if he gave you his son, then how will he not also, along with that son, graciously give you all things? That God so loved the world, which means he loves you, that he gave his one and only son for you. This is the God that Jesus came to reveal to a world full of false faith and misconceptions. And Jesus did that not by demanding to be served or to be paid back, but by being your faithful servant and giving his life as a ransom for yours. He took his perfectly faithful life, his sacrificial death, his life-giving resurrection, and credited it all to you by faith. All so that you would know him as the graciously giving God he truly is. And you do know that. St. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, "You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that you through his poverty might become rich." And here's what all of that means. That when Jesus returns and asks to see what you've done with all of his possessions, he'll see none of your unfaithfulness because he's washed it all away with his blood. He'll see none of your wasted time because all of your time, your whole life has been redeemed by his love. He'll see none of your failures or buried talents because the only thing of yours that's been buried is your sin. Because of Jesus, who is your faithful servant, he will look out over your entire life on that last day and see that it is covered in his perfect righteousness. And he will absolutely say to you with the biggest smile on his face, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I'm going to put you in charge of, I am going to bless you with infinitely more. Come, share in your master's happiness." Guaranteed. He will give you the sweetest words of affirmation your ears have ever heard as you enter into his perfectly peaceful presence, filled with his never-ending gracious gifts forevermore. Do you see how much more beautiful and freeing that is for your life than to simply turn this parable into, well, if I want to be one of the faithful ones, then I better turn my life around and start doing more faithful things with God's stuff. Brothers and sisters, you have a God who loves nothing more than to give, to forgive, to give himself, to give to you. So may he continue to then also give you strength and countless opportunities to reflect him and his grace until he returns. In Jesus' name, amen.
Brothers, sisters, let us gladly give to God our all, our best. Service hearty, thorough, honest, with a living love impressed. All our duty, all our striving, all our time to him belong. Praise him then with true devotion, come before him with a song. By his mercy, by his bounty,
we continue with the prayer of the church. Let us pray to the Lord. Almighty God, everlasting Father, you are worthy of being praised for all your gifts and graces which you have given to us, your unworthy people. Hear us this day as we cry to you for mercy on behalf of all people as they have need. You have made us your people and preserved us through the ministry of your word and sacraments. Continue to pour out on us grace upon grace, that we may be kept in faith and guarded in hope. Make your church throughout the world one in doctrine, confession, and life, and give to your church faithful pastors who will preach and teach your word with conviction. Deliver us from confusion and error by the power of your Holy Spirit, and raise up those who will continue to serve in faithfulness and humility. Deliver all enemies of your church and convert their hearts to repentance and faith. Strengthen all Christians in their faith and in their vocation of service as your children, that we may be obedient to your word and receive the salvation of our souls. Deliver the nations from oppression and ungodly rulers and governments. Bless all in authority within our own nation, that righteousness may flourish and injustice end. Bless all those places where your people teach and learn, that our children may honor you, walk in your commands, and show forth in their lives the fruits of the Spirit. Prevent all disaster and calamity. Deliver us from war and violence, and spare us from pestilence. Help us to know and rejoice in the good fruits of the earth. Bless all noble occupations, and help the arts to flourish, that our lives may be enriched by beauty. Help us to receive with thanksgiving the fruits of the earth you supply for our common good. Receive with our song of praise and sacrifice of thanksgiving the tithes and offerings we bring, that through good use of the skills, talents, and time you have given us, you may be glorified in all we are and in all we do. Give to the sick healing, to the suffering relief, to the grieving hope, and to the dying peace. Sustain us in the day of trial. Deliver us from all our enemies of body and soul, and keep us steadfast in the day of trouble. Remembering that here we have no abiding city, but heaven is our home, give us your aid, so that we may, by true faith and godly life, prepare for the coming of our Savior, doing the works you have called us to do, and accomplishing your purpose in our daily lives. Help us to multiply your mercy by loving our neighbor in need and loving you with all our body, soul, strength, and will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
To shape all my labor, your establish the work of our hands and order our steps to seek first your kingdom in every small and great task. May we live the gospel of your grace, serve your purpose in our fleeting days. Then our lives will bring eternal praise, all glory to your great name, and all glory to your great name.
Righteousness he won. Bless and save us, help and guide us, watch to comfort and restore, till in heaven we rest rejoicing, praising you.